Hatchling. He had come to the place of the Ancient Ones to find some peace within himself. He had made a sacrifice and prayed throughout the night, but there was no sign nor omen. He had rode into the sacred circle, fully armed in the burnished plate and polished mail, and his hassock of linen, snowy white and gleaming. Since childhood he had trained in the use of the sword and the dagger, the mace and the morning star, and had found good use for them all. He had fought the blue-painted Scots in the Shire of York, the Norse invaders in the East, and the non-believers in the Holy Land. As a reward, the king granted him a small fiefdom in the north of Umbria, and there he intended to stay, take a wife, and grow old. His skill was renowned, but each conquest had cost him dearly. Each deadly stroke diminished him until he did not recognize himself. Even now, he was not safe. Just yesterday, three thieves had stopped him on the muddy road, thinking to relieve him of the purse of gold at his waist. Even more evidence of the king's generosity. Wearily, he had gutted all three, not even bothering to don his helm or use his lance. Afterwards, he only felt sadness for that necessity. Crossing the borders of Umbria, he encountered many refugees who spoke of the great dragon terrorizing the populace hereabouts, and he determined to rid his new domain of this scourge. Soon he came upon a cave with a large egg and a beautiful woman inside, chained to the wall. In dulcet tones, she explained she was to be food for the hatchling when it emerged from the egg, and cast a fearful eye to the entrance. He struck off her chains and, while doing so, turned to see the egg cracking. The tiny dragonlet was helpless, but instead of killing it outright, as according to the law of the land, he found he could not. He reached out his hand and petted its scaled head. He sat and it crawled up into his lap, making small, mewling noises of hunger. Suddenly, the sky was split by a gigantic roar, and the great dragon fell upon them, her eyes red and angry, and her claws dug huge divots from the earth. Realizing this was the mother of the dragonlet, the knight took from his tunic a wheat honey cake, which the hatchling gobbled down with immense relish, stopping only to lick the man's fingers. Meanwhile, the woman waiting for his destruction was astounded to see the dragon sniffing at the man and her young licking his hand. Then she picked up her whelp by the neck and flew towards the East Mountains. The knight felt good within himself at this conclusion and took the woman to his castle as his wife. For such she became, and taught him gentility and the art of love and to play the lute. Their children were of great comfort to him, so he no longer woke in the night with visions of screaming horses and dying men in pain. His first command was to leave honey cakes in the fields and forests, so dragons were never a problem after that. And it was said that the dragon folk grew fond of honey and, indeed, looked kindly on the men. So now and again, a lost or injured child was returned mysteriously, babbling of dragons and wheat cakes. The knight was warmed by these tales and told them to the children often, while his wife looked on, knowing they were true, and loved him the more for it.